In high temperature superconductors, it's now, I think, well accepted that the symmetry is the so-called D-wave symmetry. So let's draw it like this. If you look from the top to the copper oxygen planes, the superconductivity is very strong along the copper oxygen bond directions, and it goes to zero in the so-called nodal directions, which is the 1-1-0 direction, so the diagonals in the copper oxygen planes. So the amplitude varies for different directions in the copper oxygen plane, but also the phase varies. So let's call this plus, then the other one is minus. And it means that you have a phase change in the superconducting wave function, so the order parameter of 1 pi for orthogonal directions in the copper oxygen plane. Now,
if you make an IBCO niobium ramp junction, where you have one side of the, you have two junctions on the IBCO, you have one pointing along the A axis and one along the B axis, because IBCO is a D wave superconductor, there's also another sign change in the wave function in the superconductor, whereas the niobium, because it's a BCS superconductor, an S-wave superconductor, doesn't change its sign. So if you connect those two halves of the IBCO up, then you end up with the same change and therefore having to generate a loop of half a flux quantum.
If you now make a ring and you connect such a high temperature superconductor with a low temperature superconductor, so let's draw it like this, and then maybe a little hole here inside. So this is then a low temperature superconductor, for example niobium. This is a high TC superconductor, like yttrium and copper oxide. Now the symmetry of the wave function in the niobium is a so-called S-wave symmetry. It means that there is no phase change for different directions, so let's call this plus. And now you see a funny effect. You see that if you walk around the ring, so you can make this turn here, you have a built-in pi phase shift.
The head has to bite itself, or the head of the snake has to bite itself in the tail, as you may call it.
The system by itself spontaneously generates magnetic flux enclosed in this loop. Magnetic flux to the magnitude of a half flux quantum. Because we saw before that one flux quantum connects to 2 pi phase shift, that means that half a flux quantum connects to 1 pi phase shift. And that's exactly the pi phase shift that you need to compensate for the built-in phase shift that you have due to the D-wave autoparameter symmetry. Another very interesting aspect is that the sign of this half flux quantum doesn't matter. It can be either plus or minus. So there are two possibilities, that you have a half flux quantum sticking out of the board here or going into to the board. Now, I find this very fascinating because now you have a connection of two materials, a high temperature superconductor and a low temperature superconductor, which both are non-magnetic. You don't apply any currents, you don't apply any magnetic fields. You just connect them with each other and you cool them down to below the transition temperature of both superconductors, so below the transition temperature of the niobium. And then spontaneously you get this generation of a half magnetic flux quantum.
Example of how you can use this pi phase shift effect is in superconducting electronics. And the standard architecture for superconducting electronics is the so-called rapid single flux quantum logic. And one element, for example, is the toggle flip-flop, so the T flip-flop.